Yes.
Now, on the other hand, there's a quality showing that you're not.
Yes.
My Lord.
So we got to take a look in our own lives, and we also need to look in the lives of others.
Oh,
to discern.
Yes.
We're called to judge in that manner.
Yeah.
And so, let us go back to our passage, and we're going to get this message going. It's going, but I want us to go ahead and get back to it. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, and we're going to go through there, because I want us to look at, you know, number one, how do we purify the church? How do we keep the church pure? And you can go to that next slide, Erica. The first way that we can keep the church pure is that we have to, number one, be aware of the condition of the body, the condition of our brothers and sisters in Christ. Meaning, we have to be informed of what's going on in the lives of the people that sit in these chairs.
Yeah.
We have to be discerning and be aware, because look what Paul said, it has actually been reported. Now, in order to report something, you got to have some information.
Yeah.
And that information comes by us building relationship, by us being aware, knowing about what's going on in people's lives. There's no way that we can keep the church pure if there is no, if there is secrets in everybody's lives.
Now,
I question a believer's purity. I question a believer's character when they want to always be in secret.
Wow.
When they don't want nobody coming over their house. When they want to do things in darkness.
Wow.
You got to question that. Then you in trouble.
Yes.
Wow.
Because I'm telling you, darkness, I mean, if you live in, well, okay. I'm saying that this there was a song back when I was in a world. It says, the freaks come out at night.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm just saying, there's some truth to that.
Yeah.
Because what's done in the dark, if you don't live your life in the dark and you're not coming to the light, there is some sin in your life.
Yeah.
I don't want to be secretive. You can know me. And that is the thing as believers. If we're going to keep the church pure, we need to get involved in our brother and sister life.
Yeah.
We can't allow them to live their life in darkness, because that's where they sin. That's where they fall short. And guess what? That's where the devil wants you to be. If you're dealing with stuff and the devil tell you to leave the church, don't go to church. He setting you up for that failure.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, you need the accountability, you need the light, because light exposes darkness.
Yeah.
And so, the second thing we must do is that we must mourn over sin and hate it as God does.
Amen.
I mean, you know, we can't play with sin. We can't joke about sin. We gotta take it serious.
Amen.
We can't be walking around and laughing about it. It's a serious thing. As believers, we have to hate the sin in our lives. We gotta hate the sin in other people's lives.
That's right.
We gotta hate sin, period. Because God hates sin. And remember, as his children, we possess a part of his quality.
Yes, Lord.
So part of that quality is that we have to hate sin.
Yeah.
And so that means that we're quick to to, number one, keep ourselves accountable, but we're also quick to hold each other accountable. When you see something in your brother and sister life, pull them to a side and say, hey, man, you know what, brother? Let me tell you something.
Yeah.
And guess what? You don't have to put it out in other people's business. It's not for the pastor job. It's not for the pastor wife job. It's that if you know something about your brother and sister,
sit next to them, like, man, let us have a talk. Let me tell you something.
And then, why? You do it not for the fact to say, you know, I just want to show him what he's doing, but you do it for the purity of that brother. Your sister or your brother for the sake of the body.
The individual
does get the benefit, but it's for the body, it's for the collective body as a whole though. What the individual does, it affects everybody. And so we as believers, we must hate sin. We must hate it with passion.
Yes.
And so, you know, even with that in mind, let us make sure that we are tailoring our lives to make sure that we're not cultivating sin, cultivating opportunities of sin. Amen. So we have to remember, we as believers, we have to live thoughtful lives. That means things that we, places we go, things that we listen to, things that we wear, things that we say, all of those things, we have to be thoughtful about it.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Because that's what God expects. If we're going to live a life that is sanctified, a life that is holy, it takes thoughtfulness. We just can't, can't get out there and do any and everything. It has to take thoughtfulness about what we do. And then the third thing, if we look at verse 3-5, he says, for indeed, as absent in the body, but present in the spirit, have already judged as though I were present, him who has done this deed in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, when you are gathered together along with my spirit, with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ, deliver such a one to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. So, the third thing we must do is we want to keep a purified church, and we want to keep the church pure, is that we must judge our fellow believers, excluding those who violate the word of God and refuse to repent, for the purpose of rescuing their souls, bringing them to repentance.
Yes.
So when we judge others and when we come and confront somebody for sin, we're doing it to help save this person. Their soul. And we must, as Paul said, we must exclude them if they fail to repent. See, because as believers, we're called to repentance. Now you can look in your life, you can look at everybody's life as believers. Nobody is perfect. Amen. But God calls us to repentance. See, one of the marks of a true believer is that they are living a life of repentance. That when sin is represented in their lives, they turn from it. They're not continuing in sin.
That's good.
But they are turning from sin.
Yes, Lord.
And so, those who fail to turn from sin, we gotta, number one, we have to treat them as an unbeliever. And remove them from the body, exclude them, judge them. Meaning, we have to put them out. Because as we're gonna go to the, you can go to the next slide, Erica. We have to understand that we must realize how sin contaminates a camp, meaning a local body of believers.
Yes.
Un, un, hidden sin, sin that's not confronted will mess the entire body up. It's like cancer.
Yes.
If they don't remove it from it, it's gonna affect the entire body.
Yes.
So that's why they go in and cut it out. So that it can preserve the life of the individual.
Yes, Lord.
The body. And remember that we are a body. We as believers, we are the body.
Yes.
Everybody makes up the body. And so what happens if there's an individual among us that is living a lifestyle that is immoral, we and fails to repent, we must remove them. Based on the scripture. Why? So that the entire body won't be affected.
Yes,
because this, remember that the body of Christ is just that. The body of Christ.
Yes, it is.
Which is called to be a holy body that is set apart.
Yes.
And so sin contaminates the entire body and it begins to spread into the lives of the other individuals.
Yeah.
So somebody say, you know what, man? Yeah, I saw such and such doing this, man. And so, you know what? I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
Remember, because we also influence each other.
Yeah.
And so if there's somebody, you know, if another believer is looking up to somebody and they say, you know what, so such and such is doing it and they're not dealing with it, maybe it's okay. Maybe it's right. Maybe it's fine to do it. And so that sin begins to contaminate the entire body. And so it's like a flu, you know, in a house. You know, you gotta, you know, sometimes you gotta contaminate that one family member to the room. And you know, pass them some food underneath the door. Because if not, it's going to spread to the entire family.
Yes.
And so we have to understand how sin contaminates the entire body. So we have to deal with it. And exclude them for the purpose of saving the entire body.
Yes, Lord.
And so the next thing that we look at is in verses 9 through 12, where it talks about breaking a tie with those people who fail to repent. Verse 9 through 12 says, I wrote to you in my epistle not to keep company with sexually immoral people. Yet I certainly did not mean with the sexually immoral people of this world, or with the covetousness of the world, or extortionists, or adulterers, since then you would need to go out of the world. But now I have written to you not to keep company with anyone named a brother or a sister. So the word brother is synonymous. It also means sister. So if you're not excluded from that sister, but it's talking about the body. It says, who is sexually immoral or covetous or an adulterer or a reviler or a drunkard or an extortionist, not even to eat with such a person. And so basically Paul is telling them that you got to break all ties with those who are living an immoral life and confess, and of those who confess to be saints.
Yes.
And so he's not talking about those who are in the world, because that is expected. We expect those people in the world to live sexually immoral lives. It's expected. It's expected for them to be drunken, you know, drunkards and covetousness. We expect them because they are of the world. That is their quality. Remember, they're part of that. That's their father. They have the quality of their father. On the other hand, if it's somebody that's named a brother or a sister, we need to deal with them. We need to exclude them, because they basically say, you know what, I'm a brother, I'm a sister, but then you living like you're not. We have to do something about it. That we need to break all ties. And you know what? It may even be your family member.
Yeah.
That you gotta exclude. And this is
when you said don't even have, fellas, don't even eat with them.
I know that sound harsh, like, man, what?
Yes, if it's a person who claims to be a believer and they're living an immoral lifestyle where they don't want to repent, you are called to exclude them, even if it's your family member.
Yes.
Because the scripture commands us to.
And also is going to bring that person to repentance.
Yes.
The scripture says, turn them over to Satan. Let the devil put a whooping on them.
Yeah.
They won't.
Yeah.
Let him do it. You remember, God uses everything to fulfill his purpose. Yeah, he used the devil to draw others to him. Put that whooping on them. Turn them over. And so, the last thing that we do is, the last thing that we need to do if we're going to have a church that is pure is that we got to dismiss this notion.
Amen.
You can't judge me.
Amen.
This is a lie.
Look what verse 13 says. It says, verse 12 through 13, it says, for what have I to do with judging those who are outside? Do you not judge those who are inside? But those who are outside, God judges. Therefore, put away from yourself the evil perversion.
Yes.
And so, we have to dismiss this lie that you can't judge. My brothers and sisters, I submit to you, we must judge.
Because
if we don't judge, then everything will be able to creep up in our body and the church will be contaminated.
We have to
investigate our lives. We got to investigate the lives of others using discernment.
We got eyes, we got to see. We got to call black is black, purple is purple.
Yes.
If you see it, then guess what?
Judge it.
You judge it. You have to say, call it out.
Yes.
And so it is important for us to do that because God calls us to be a church that is sanctified, a church that is set apart, a church that is free from immorality, not a church that is perfect, because none of us are perfect, but a church that is full of accountability, full of people who love God, full of people who want to live holy, sanctified lives. And if you're dealing with sin like that, those who really don't want to live, guess what? You may see them not come back.
Yeah.
And guess what? That's a blessing. That's a blessing. Because we want to weed out. This is a process to weed out those who are fake. Those who are real believers will deal with sin in their own life, and they will deal with sin in others' lives.
So,
I just wanted to edify, the body just by bringing that message through 1 Corinthians chapter 5, the entire book. When you get a chance, read Leviticus chapter 18, the entire chapter. Read it, because you're going to see our culture today in it.
Amen.
But know this, that as believers, we're called to be distinct, to be different, to live in such a way that glorifies God.
Amen.
So the doors of the church are open,
Amen.
If you come for a testimony, I don't have